So the primary endpoint of the study was progression-free survival, fairly standard endpoint, profound differences there. Probably the most illustrative is really the two-year figure. So 85% progression-free with the venetoclax compared to 36% with the bendamustine rituximab. One of the questions often is, well, was the comparison arm underperforming? Our median PFS was 17.1 months, actually somewhat superior to the previous trial. So we're very confident that our comparator performed very well, and yet we were still able to see profound and very impactful improvement beyond that in terms of progression-free survival. What's the mechanism of that? I think the far deeper responses. So in terms of MRD negativity, we have most of the data in peripheral blood, so I'll cite those figures, but 62% MRD negativity at the end of the combination treatment period compared to 13%, and very encouraging sustained MRD negativity in the Murano data. So even with median two-year follow-up, we're seeing a reduction in death rate by 7% at this two-year point, p-value 0.018. We really have three strata of patients in the front line. So there are elderly or frail patients where we cannot safely deliver chemoimmunotherapy. In the US, ibrutinib is established in that context and delivers very, very good and generally well tolerated. There are some bleeding risks, some AF risk, but generally very well tolerated and durable disease control. But it does not eradicate the disease, and continuous therapy is required. So very reasonable to ask the question of comparing the two in that context. Now, different patient profile risks. Venetoclax has no cardiac signal, so it can safely be given in that context, but issues with renal function, coping with biochemical changes, with rapid cell killing, there may be some concerns in the elderly and the frail, even though the German group have shown the safety of delivering that, so it may fit different patient profiles. In the younger and fitter patients, then disease biology emerges. There are those with good prognostic factors, what we call the hypermutated immunoglobulin gene status, where chemoimmunotherapy, even though it's unfashionable and even though there is a swing moving away from it, it's potentially curative. So there is a very difficult and appropriate threshold for displacing that. Where I see appeal in the shorter term of the venetoclax combinations is in those with the unfavorable, unmutated IGVH status, who are not curable with chemoimmunotherapy, and where repeated treatment with the risk of myelodysplasia and selection for P53 mutated clones is a significant concern. So it becomes more nuanced in the frontline setting. But venetoclax as a partner in combination either with the CD20 antibody, or we're beginning to see exciting data with BTK, ibrutinib, venetoclax combinations are where I see the appeal of moving those into the frontline context in the setting of biologic parameters that predict for patients who are not going to be cured with chemoimmunotherapy.